I am Shivangi Garg with the Branding Committee, and I'll be introducing the speaker for the day. Professor Reddy is a faculty member at the International Institute of Information Technology, Bangalore, since 2018. He received his PhD from Nanyang Technological University, NTU, Singapore in 2013. Prior to joining IIIT Bangalore, he had worked as a postdoctoral researcher at NTU for 2 years and in the industry for about 7 years. His research interests include array processing and signal processing for acoustic, biomedical, and radar applications. Professor Reddy currently serves as the controller of examinations at IIIT Bangalore. Today, Professor Vinod Reddy will be talking on radars. The use of radars has been on the rise in recent years, despite being a century-old topic of study. The amalgamation of pulsed wave and continuous wave radars gave rise to frequency-modulated continuous wave, FMCW radar, that opened up several opportunities and places where its use was unanticipated. In this talk, Dr. Reddy will first carve out the space for FMCW radar amidst conventional radars. Then we will observe the wide spectrum of opportunities that open up for FMCW radars in commercial and industrial applications. Dr. Vinod Reddy will, in addition, discuss some of the design challenges of FMCW radar that needs attention. We warm-heartedly welcome you, sir. We also warmly welcome the audience and thank you for your continued support. Thank you.
Thank you, Shivangi. Welcome to this talk. The title is FMCW Radars, Evolution, Opportunities and Challenges. Here, FMCW stands for Frequency Modulated Continuous Wave Radars. And it's a type of radar which has recently drawn a lot of attention. As you know, radar has been there for a century now or even more. But what makes it more relevant even today is this unique kind of radar, that's FMCW radars. And therefore, we have chosen this topic for today's discussion. The outline of this talk is we'll provide a motivation and then move on to discuss the pulsed wave, continuous wave radars before we carve out the space for FMCW radars. We then look at the evolution of FMCW radars, which has happened till now, and look at what are the possible opportunities making use of this particular radar to accomplish for, incorporate for several other applications as well. We then discuss a specific research problem, that is microdoppler analysis using FMCW radar, that our team is working. We then discuss some challenges which are existing and then summarize the talk. So taking a step back, if we look at the radar applications that have been widely observed, these applications were basically motivated by defense organizations or space organizations initially. So if you take note of the first radar, which is shown here, this is a 3D target detection and tracking radar, which can detect more than one targets in real time, and the targets can be as far as 180 to 200 kilometers from the radar. And it should be a very powerful radar to do this particular operation. And as you see here, this is a DRDO radar system developed by DRDO. One other radar which you see here to the right is a space monitoring radar. This is a very fascinating setup, which is in Satish Dhawan Space Center. The antenna is mounted on top of a four-story building where the top two stories are dedicated for data processing itself that is being acquired by the radar. Here, the radar looks up in the sky to detect any targets possible. But what are the possible targets that can be up in the sky? The nearest ones in the sky would be the Leo Earth orbit objects present in Leo Earth orbit satellite trajectory, which means this radar will be capable of detecting small space debris that would be revolving around the Earth in the Leo Earth orbit. Therefore, the detection range of this, the targets which are as far as 1,000 kilometers from this particular radar can be detected and also be tracked in real time. That's the kind of sophistication as well as efficiency of this particular radar is. And if you look at another application, that is air traffic control. I'm sure most of you are aware of this particular radar, which is present in most of the airports to identify and track the aircrafts that are coming in and leaving the airport, right? So this is a clear-cut commercial application which has been there for several years now. One other application which has been of very much importance for space and defense organizations as well is imaging capabilities of a radar. Here, a landscape is imaged with the help of a radar instead of a camera, right? So here, what happens is you would have mounted a radar on an unmanned aerial vehicle, UAV, and the UAV would follow a specific path trying to image the land underneath, okay? So the radar can either be mounted on the UAV or it can be mounted even in low Earth orbit satellites as well, okay? So just imagine that a radar, which is as far as say 200 kilometers, if it is on a, mounted on a UAV, or up to 2000 kilometers in a low Earth orbit satellite, can indeed image the landscape with a resolution of a few meters. So that's a fascinating accomplishment with a specific principle known as synthetic aperture principle, is what they can image the landscape. So these are some of handpicked kind of applications from the literature. And one thing which is common among all these four applications is targets are mostly very, very far from radar. Okay. So if we look at additional applications, what we observe more recently is that radars have been able to detect targets which are not as far as before. One of the foremost or popular applications is the use of radar in automotive industry for advanced driver assistance systems or even for autonomous driving. Okay. And one other interesting application is vital signs monitoring, wherein the radar, even not mounted on the person, can identify or detect the breathing rate and heart rate of a person. And nowadays, radars have been designed to even identify a person falling down and some other activities that happen which needs attention. This kind of requirement is very much necessary for elderly care systems. Okay, so and the biggest advantage of using radar against a camera, for example, would be the privacy preserving capability of radar, which means mounting a radar in a house or in a room does not intrude your privacy just like a camera. Okay, it doesn't detect who the person is, but it just ensures that some activities that are of interest are being detected. So that's the one of the unique capabilities of radar. Other applications of radar in the industry have been for fault detection in transmission lines. And in fact, I worked on fault detection in pipes, buried pipes as well. So here the radar transmits a signal along the pipe, and if there is any defect, there will be some kind of a reflection from the point where the defect is present. And based on the transit time computation, you exactly know where the defect is and thereby saving time. So there are two other applications that I will be discussing about. These are put under this category because ground penetration radar is widely used for detecting landmines and in the defense context or in commercial context. This is used to detect underground pipes as well as say a railway track monitoring as well. Okay, and through the wall radar is used to identify and understand human activities that are behind the wall. Okay. So in all these applications, targets are not as far as what we observed in the earlier discussed applications. So overall, if we look at radar as a sensing modality, what are the advantages that stand out? The first one is radars are all weather performance, 24/7, whether there is light or not, it doesn't matter, right? And radars are capable of ranging and imaging as well. Relevance for commercial applications, privacy preserving, and becoming a low cost solution by the day. So now one question from whatever we have discussed so far is, what is the difference between radars used for detecting far off targets and near targets? Can the same radar be used for both activities? The answer is no. And if no, why? To answer why, we'll have to look at the working principle of some of the radars, which we will do next. To start off, we'll look at pulsed wave radars. Here, we transmit a wave which is only short-lived. That's the reason why it's called pulsed wave radar. Transmits a short wave, the wave hits the target and gets scattered in all the directions. A small component of that comes back to the radar. By then, the transmitter is switched into a receiver. The same antenna is switched into a receiver and receives the signal back. Okay, so here in this illustration, we transmit a small pulse and then it becomes a receiver and starts listening to the response from various targets. So in this illustration, we have three different targets at three distances, and the response due to each of the targets are delayed from the transmitted time. And the delay is proportional to twice the distance of propagation. Okay, and the amplitude of the received signal is inversely proportional to the square of the distance. Okay, so now if the target is stationary, what happens is if you transmit one pulse, the response from that particular target will be received after a specific time instant, proportional to its range. If you transmit one more pulse, the received pulse with respect to the start of this particular pulse would receive at the same delay as it had received for the previous pulse, and so on. If you transmit 100 pulses, you would have the same relative delay with respect to the corresponding pulse. If the target is moving, for example, then what happens is there would be a small delay in introduced. For instance, for the first pulse, the target was at a specific distance and you got a specific delay proportional to that particular distance. when you transmit the next pulse, there would be a marginal movement of the target, and therefore this delay would be there would be a very, very small fraction of a delay incorporated here. And this delay would translate into a phase change when compared to this particular pulse, and so on. With subsequent pulses, there would be a small change in phase that is proportional to the target velocity or the Doppler velocity, or Doppler frequency corresponding to the target velocity. So what we observe here is, when you transmit a pulse and receive the response, you can easily estimate the target distance if you process the response at one go. To estimate the velocity of the target, what you have to do is, you will have to process across pulses. And therefore, what you do is, you bring the response for the second pulse under the first pulse, third pulse again under the first pulse, and you look across the pulses at the specific delay, which is proportional to a specific range, and try to estimate the velocity of the target. So this is an example range Doppler map. This can also be treated as a range velocity map. Here we have plotted the Doppler frequency, which is proportional to the velocity. So this is RD map, or range Doppler map, obtained for a high frequency radar mounted along the coast of a country. So here what we observe is, there are several targets here. Okay, these small highlighted points are the targets. And to be clear, this particular target, if we try to interpret what this RD map gives us, this target is at 23 kilometers from the radar and moving at a Doppler frequency of -1 hertz, okay? -1 hertz. A negative Doppler frequency implies that the target is moving away from the radar. And this frequency can be translated to target velocity. For example, this radar is operating at 16 megahertz. At 16 megahertz, 1 hertz of Doppler frequency translates to 33 kilometers per second. Therefore, this target is moving at 33 kilometers per second away from the radar. So if you have multiple receive antennas, what you can do is, you can also extract the direction of that particular target with respect to the radar. Okay, in this particular application, we had 16 receive antenna, and therefore we could estimate the direction of the target very, very accurately. Okay, so bottom line is, you can estimate the target distance, target velocity, and target direction as well. So what are the parameters? To summarize, what are the parameters that pulse wave radars give? It is the range, target range, velocity, direction, and RCS. RCS is radar cross section. This is a parameter that is extracted based on the signal strength that is received. This can approximately give you an idea of what kind of a target that is, based on its reflectivity and based on its size. Okay, so these are the four parameters that people generally extract from pulsed wave radars. Some of the additional capabilities of pulsed wave radars is, so we know that at regular intervals of time, for a given target, you can get these parameters. So over time, what you can do is, you can, based on these information, you can track that particular target. Very simple. And pulsed wave radars are also used for synthetic aperture imaging. One other advantage with pulsed wave radars is, you can characterize the targets based on radar cross section to identify what kind of a target it can be, and so on. So bottom line is, you get some approximate idea of what the target is. Okay. So one of the limitations of pulsed wave radar that needs to be highlighted is, while transmitting, this particular radar does not receive any signal. And thereby, what happens is, if, let's assume the pulse duration is, say, 1 microsecond. So if the target is at a specific distance, the delay would be proportional to the target distance. Okay, as the target approaches the radar, okay, the response due to the target also gets close to the time when the transmit signal was transmitted. If the target comes very close to the radar, then what happens is, before the completion of transmission, there will be some response from the receiver, from the target that has already arrived. That kind of a response cannot be picked by pulsed wave radars. Therefore, there will be a blind spot in the near range of the pulsed wave radar. Okay, which means what? Pulsed wave radars are suitable for applications where the targets are situated far away, okay, and not for applications where the radar, the targets are very close to the radar. Now let us look at the other kind of radar called continuous wave radar. This is a very, very simple implementation. I mean, this has a very low hardware complexity, and why, we will take a look at it immediately. So this is the block diagram of a continuous wave radar. What it does is, it generates a continuous wave signal at a specific frequency F0. It keeps transmitting the signal at a frequency F0, amplifies and transmits. Well, as it transmits, continuous wave radar would have a different receive antenna which keeps receiving the signal at all time, okay? So in earlier days, these two, the same antenna was used, but the problem was there would be a phase noise which was leaking from the transmit to the receive, and therefore people decided to design with a separate transmit and receive antenna. So as transmitter keeps transmitting a signal, receiver keeps receiving the signal. So if there are targets in the scene, there would be a response from each of the targets that would be summed up and received here. If the target is stationary, then whatever signal is transmitted, the signal with received would have the same frequency. It does not change. If the target is moving, then due to the Doppler effect, you would have a small shift in the frequency of the signal that is received. If the target is moving closer to the radar, frequency would be higher than F0. If the target is moving away, frequency would be lesser than F0. Okay, the received signal is immediately multiplied by the transmitted signal in the mixer. And this mixer, what it does is it multiplies, and as a result gives two components. One signal which has a frequency which is the difference of these two, and the other one which is the sum of these two. And therefore, what this particular filter, what it does is it filters out the higher frequency component and picks only the lower frequency component. Okay, when this picks the lower frequency component, what happens is that would not have the original signal. It would only have the response due to the target, that is the Doppler frequency. That's the beauty. If there are more than one targets, the signal here received would be a sum of the corresponding Doppler frequencies. Okay, so that would be processed to get more information about the targets present in the scene. One of the disadvantages of continuous wave radar is it cannot estimate the delay in the received signal in comparison with the transmitted signal, and therefore it cannot estimate the target range. Okay, if you look at this particular spectrum, what it shows is a time frequency plot of the way the target moves with respect to the radar. A negative frequency, Doppler frequency indicates that the target is moving away with a constant velocity and then turns around and approaches the radar at a constant velocity. This is a target, this is a human target basically in front of the continuous wave radar. He moves away and then approaches the radar later. So from this particular plot, what you can extract is the speed at which the human is walking away from the radar or moving close to the radar. And what we also observe is some of the additional signatures that you observe here. What is this? When if you consider human as a target, the motion, the speed at which he walks would be equal to the speed at which the person is walking. If his, but what you also know is his hands and legs keep moving. And due to that, you encounter what is known as micro motions of that particular target. And these additional signatures are due to the micro motions, which are also, this signature is called micro Doppler signature, which means what? The received signal would have Doppler frequency as well as the micro Doppler signature embedded in the signal. Okay. So what are the target parameters that are that can be estimated from the radar? First thing is it can estimate the velocity. Then if there are multiple receive antenna, you can estimate the direction of the target with respect to the radar. Some of the applications of this radar is, it is used for speed guns, it's used in through the wall imaging, and it's also used for blood flow measurement in ultrasound systems. Of course, it's not a radar, it's an ultrasound signal that is being transmitted, but the working principle is very similar to a continuous wave radar. The additional capabilities of this radar is target characterization based on micro Doppler signature. And this radar can also be used for imaging, particularly in through the wall kind of a context. So in the presence of micro motions, the down converted signal here is modulated by the micro Doppler signature, something which I just now mentioned. So if we list down the, if we try to compare pulsed wave and continuous wave radar, what we note is in pulsed wave radar, target response is received only after transmission, whereas in continuous wave radar, target response is continuously received with the receive antenna. So therefore, pulsed wave radar in pulsed wave radar, each antenna is a transceiver. In continuous wave radar, antenna is either a transmitter or a receiver. And the pulsed wave radar is capable of estimating the target range, which the continuous wave radar cannot. One of the setbacks of pulsed wave radar is blind spots. Pulsed wave radar has a blind spot because it receives only after the transmission is complete, as opposed to the continuous wave radar. Therefore, continuous wave radar does not have a blind spot. Pulsed wave radars have a hardware which is expensive because the analog to digital converter would have to run at higher sampling frequencies. And with higher sampling frequency, data per second is large and it has to be handled appropriately. Therefore, the hardware is expensive compared to continuous wave radar. Now, what we observe here is continuous wave radar does not have a blind spot, but the disadvantages, it cannot estimate range. What would be desirable is to have a continuous wave radar that can identify or detect the target range. Then I think everything would fall in place. And therefore, if we look at FMCW radar, FMCW stands for frequency modulated continuous wave radar. This is a special case of continuous wave radar where a chirp signal is transmitted instead of a continuous signal. We'll discuss about that. But to highlight some of the advantages here, target response is received during signal transmission, similar to continuous wave radar. Antenna is either a transmitter or a receiver, similar to continuous wave radar. Range estimation is possible, like a pulsed wave radar. No blind spots, like a continuous wave radar. Enables target micro Doppler signature and hardware is cost effective, very similar to continuous wave radar. Okay, so now let us look at how FMCW radar came up, or the working principle of FMCW radar, and then we'll look at its evolution. So the block diagram of FMCW radar is almost identical to that of a continuous wave radar, except for instead of transmitting a continuous wave signal at only a specific frequency, you transmit what is known as a chirp signal. What is a chirp signal? It is a frequency modulated signal whose frequency keeps changing with time. Okay, most often people use a linear frequency modulation signal. Okay, so a chirp signal is transmitted through the transmitter. It strikes the target and the scattered response comes back at the receiver, mixed with the transmitted signal, filtered to get the low pass component, and then you digitize and process the signal. Now, how should this particular radar estimate the range, target range? To understand that, take a look at the transmitted signal in a time frequency representation. So the FMCW signal is a signal where its frequency changes with time. This red signal was transmitted, and you observe that the frequency keeps increasing with time linearly. Okay. Now it strikes the target and the scattered response comes back. The received signal is slightly delayed, correct? It's slightly delayed, and therefore the linear frequency variation will be very similar to how it was transmitted, just it is delayed. Now, when you mix the signal with the transmitted signal, you know that the transmitted signal was early, right? So because of that, you see that this line is actually a bit advanced in time compared to the received time frequency response. And therefore, when you mix at a given time instant, you see that there is a constant frequency difference between the transmitted signal and the received signal. Same is true at any time instant within the duration of overlap. This translates to a specific signal with frequency which is proportional to this particular delay. Okay, if the delay is large, then what happens? The frequency difference between the transmit signal and the received signal will be large. And what does that mean? This delay is, as you know, is proportional to the target distance, which means this particular frequency difference is proportional to the target distance. And therefore, based on the frequency of the IF signal, you can estimate the target distance. So that's the takeaway here. Of course, there would be the Doppler frequency proportional to the target velocity, which is embedded here. However, the range frequency will be higher than the Doppler frequency, and therefore with this you cannot estimate the Doppler frequency, the target velocity. In order to estimate the target velocity, what people do is they transmit multiple chirps. One of the reason is you start this particular transmission at a specific F0, and you continuously transmit the signal until it reaches F1. You cannot keep continuous transmitting the signal with increasing frequency indefinitely, because it goes to infinity. Frequency goes to infinity. Therefore, you will have to reset. And when you reset, if you transmit, bring it back to F0 and transmit once again, this looks like you are transmitting multiple chirps, very similar to multiple pulses that you transmitted in pulsed wave radar. And the responses are according to the receive antenna. Receive antenna simultaneously receives as you transmit. So that is the difference between FMCW versus a pulsed wave radar. Okay, in pulsed wave radar, receive would happen only after the transmission is complete. Okay, that's the basic difference. But now, since you have multiple chirps that are being transmitted, velocity, target velocity can be extracted across chirps by stacking one the target response one below the other. Okay, and thereby you get a range Doppler map, just like in pulsed wave radar, where you can identify the target range and velocity. So if you look at the parameters that can be extracted from FMCW radar, you can estimate range, velocity. If you have multiple receive antenna, you can estimate the direction. You can also estimate the radar cross section as well. Very similar to pulsed wave radar. Additional target capabilities. Targets can be tracked. Target characterization now can be based on both RCS, radar cross section, as well as micro Doppler signature. Okay. And this kind of radar can also be used for imaging. So to just show you how it looks like. So this is an example from the literature where a drone is present at a distance of 33 meters. And in the range versus Doppler or velocity plot, you can clearly observe that it is moving at 3.4 meters per second and at a distance of 33 meters. Okay, so this is unlike pulsed wave radar, this radar can detect a target which is as close as 33 meters. Okay, that's one of the takeaways. And as far as characterization of the target is concerned, if you look at the continuous wave response of continuous wave radar for a human walking, you could see clear motion of hands and legs and so on, right? As well as the target motion. I mean, this was one of the signatures that we acquired for a human walking away as well as arriving. So we could see that we can observe the target moving away as well as some additional components that are present, which are an indication of micro Doppler signature. So basically what we see here is we get the best of both the worlds, that is the pulsed wave as well as continuous wave radars in FMCW radar. And now let us look at the evolution of FMCW radars. What we saw just now is some of the fascinating applications, but it is actually surprising to understand that the FMCW radars were conceptualized sometime way back in 1960s, to be precise, 1962, where the concept, the paper title was Range Measuring Doppler Radar. Okay, that's the first instance. And then what you see is in some development in 1970s, of course, there was a lot of developments, but notable ones were in 1970s. Here in 1972, automotive radar was conceptualized with the help of both pulsed wave as well as FMCW radars. And there were other efforts for the detection of buried objects using FMCW radars. This was an illustration from the paper that came up in 1972. The concept there was the human who is driving the car can see the targets which are present in front of him, but he would not be able to see the vehicles that are coming behind. I mean, of course, there is a rear view camera. There would be some side view cameras, but there are some blind areas which are present. You can see that there can be some compact cars which are which can be present in the blind spots, and those need to be informed to the driver to keep track of. And that was the original motivation for automotive radars. But nowadays, it is not only this, radars are used even to see in front of the car for driver assistance, and as well as we are now looking at driver not present at all, right? If you look at the developments in 1980s, there were some interesting signal processing developments to detect targets more efficiently. And some efforts were put in distinguishing the type of hidden objects as well. Okay, this was one of the systems developed in 1980s, wherein they are trying to check the composition of this particular brick. Okay, this is the radar. This is called as a wedge, which provides a low resistance path for the signal to propagate and enter the medium. Okay. In 1990s, once again, there was significant development in signal processing algorithms. One such contribution was, noteworthy contribution was an algorithm which could overcome the limitations of the velocity estimation. Most of the radars, the way they are designed, there would be an upper limit on the kind of velocities that the radar can estimate for the targets. If the target is goes beyond the velocity upper limit of the velocity, then there would be an ambiguity in the velocity estimation. There were some algorithms to circumvent such a challenge in 1990s, precisely 1997. Okay, in the same year, what we observed was a nice 77 gigahertz antenna in PCB format. Okay, this is a reflect. This is an antenna with a reflector present here. Okay, so that the signal which is sent here is reflected onto this particular plane, and then the signal is once again reflected here to go ahead. Okay, so in 2000s. There were some work on the kind of phase noise that leaks from the transmit to receive, as well as the problem of coupling was carefully studied, and the design of front end was emphasized a lot in 2000s. And the concept of MIMO radars came up in the year of 2007, which is very, very fascinating. Initially, the way it used to be is if there were transmit antennas, there were receive antennas, the direction estimated with the help of the receive antenna would be not as accurate as we want. Okay, so with only four receive antenna, you would hardly get fine details of the azimuthal view that you have. It would not be comparable with your camera, for example. But now, with the help of with the help of the concept of MIMO, multiple input, multiple output, what came up was a virtual receive array kind of a concept, with which the receive array would be as big as the transmit and receive antenna put together. Okay, the aperture would be so big that you could precisely estimate the target direction. So that's a phenomenal, wonderful concept which can improve the performance of radars in imaging the scene. Okay, so from 2010 onwards, it has picked up significantly because of the compactness of the hardware and some of the interesting concepts such as OFDM and pulse modulated continuous wave radars and some sub Nyquist radars and several applications of FMCW radar came up after 2007. So in terms of hardware, particularly, I like this particular figure borrowed from this paper, wherein it shows how the hardware evolved in a span of about 8 years. In 2010, you see that the radar had several components with the VCO, multiplier, switch, low noise amplifier, mixers, and so on. These were all put together to form a compact system in 2014. And if you see in 2018, you have the antenna and ramp generator most of the radar components in one chip, and an additional microcontroller to process the signal that is received. That's the kind of evolution, hardware evolution that's happening now. And it's no surprise that the applications and commercial applications are picking up so spontaneously. So now, if you look at, based on this kind of an evolution for FMCW radars, if you look at some of the opportunities that lie in front of us, first look at developmental opportunities. If we see, we now have hardware evaluation boards by more than one companies here. So these help you in quickly coming up with proof of concepts for various, the kind of application that you think of. Okay, this is an entire radar by itself with the antenna also present on the chip. Okay, this is the radar chip, and there are supporting hardware here, and it would directly give you a set, it also embeds software of itself and gives you the target point clouds. What are target point clouds? These are the positional information of various targets detected by the radar. Therefore, it's very much at your disposal to come up with an application, and these evaluation boards also come with their own with an additional microcontroller embedded here. So why so? It is to give you flexibility to develop your software, making use of the point clouds that the radar gives, and get it working on the same board, and you can show the proof of concept. With such a kind of platforms available, identifying new applications is the need of the hour. So next, one of the opportunities is in sensor fusion, because now with more and more sensing modalities coming up, it makes sense to combine more than one sensors to complement each other and come up with a sophisticated system, sophisticated and a robust system in some applications. Cost and size for commercial applications is certainly a topic of developmental opportunity, because of course there are new and new chips coming up with cost coming down. You should be in, one should be in a position to plug and play radars, okay, commercial radars. Something like a GPS receiver, which you use it in your phone, in your watch, in your in your laptop or in your vehicle, and so on. Radar should be such. Okay. So, what are the research opportunities that are at our end? Scene reconstruction is one of the research challenge that one faces with radars. Particularly because with limited space, the number of antenna that can be incorporated in the application would, in the system box, would be limited. Therefore, reconstructing the scene with a very high resolution will be a challenge unless you use sensor fusion or you come up with new techniques such as synthetic aperture processing for FMCW radars, right? So such kind of concepts can be incorporated to generate scene at a fast pace in real time, okay? One of the other research opportunities is object characterization or classification based on be it texture or micro motions, environment, sensor fusion, any of these. Okay. New upcoming kind of radar designs such as pulse modulated continuous wave radar, sorry, not pulse modulated, it's phase modulated continuous wave radars or sub-Nyquist radars. Sub-Nyquist radars are new designs of radars wherein the computational complexity and the hardware complexity are being brought down below the Nyquist criterion, making it to be extremely low cost kinds. A new upcoming field is joint radar communication. This is a very interesting idea because see, radar anyway transmits signal and receives back. If it's doing the job of transmission, why not you transmit some information out? If there is a receiver, it can pick up, and therefore communication can also be established along with ranging. So that's the concept which is used, and thereby reducing the bandwidth and so on, right? So bandwidth as well as hardware. So that's one of the recent areas that have been active in radar community. So what I would be talking now is an efficient way to extract micro-Doppler signature, efficient way to extract micro-Doppler signature from FMCW radars. So first is, what is micro-Doppler signature? It's the response due to micro motions of individual body segments that ride on the Doppler signature. Okay, this was the example that we spoke of. This is the Doppler signature. When we look at the time frequency representation, and these are the additional signals that is riding on the Doppler signature. We term this as micro-Doppler signature, okay? So several studies have been done, particularly, I mean, as an example, this is a human walking, right? Careful analysis of the human motion has been done thoroughly by this particular, in this particular book. And they show that they can simulate a human walking with various, the contribution of various parts of the body in the micro-Doppler signature. This is this one cycle corresponds to one spike here. Okay, so you can observe that a thorough study can give you a lot of information about the target and therefore characterizing it. So now, what is the first thing is, we know that FMCW radar can also detect the range. And how do we do that? With the help of range Doppler map. Therefore, we should see how the presence of micro Doppler affects the range Doppler map. If you take a look at the presence of, here we acquired data from a running ceiling fan. Okay, so the target is stationary, therefore the Doppler frequency is zero, but the blades are moving, which is the micro motions, and therefore there is a spread in the signature here. This is the micro-Doppler signature that is present, okay? And these are the multipath within the house. I mean, this is an indoor data acquisition. These are multipath. We can clearly say that because nothing else was moving in the scene. Therefore, this has to be multipath due to the signal scattered by the blades of the fan. If you look at another instance, this is the response of the drone, which we saw here. What we observed is, this is the target response at a distance 33 meters and a velocity of 3.4 meters per second. But what we observe is a big spread along the Doppler axis. This is due to the response of the blades. The blades of the drone, the rotor blades of the drone, rotate at a speed of somewhere between 10,000 to 40,000 rotations per minute, as against about some 300 to 500 RPM for a ceiling fan. Okay, so what do we observe from these plots? We observe a Doppler spread due to micro Doppler signature. The spread is actually proportional to micro motion speed and chirp repetition interval. This is something which we cannot clearly infer, but a simple observation is the micro Doppler due to fan here is spread from minus three kilohertz to plus 3 kilohertz of Doppler frequency. Here, it has spread over the entire region, entire Doppler region. Of course, it's not measured in Doppler, it's measured in velocity. But you see that it looks like what has happened is the spread is so much that it has wrapped, it has gone beyond the maximum velocity limit and has created ambiguity there due to aliasing effect, something known as aliasing effect. We'll discuss that. So we will observe aliasing when micro Doppler frequency spread is large and large enough to be more than the maximum velocity that the radar can estimate. Okay. So how do we go about handling micro Doppler? The most conventional way people have gone towards handling micro Doppler frequencies, first to identify target in range Doppler map and estimate its distance from the radar. Then spectrogram or time frequency analysis is performed at this particular range bin across multiple chirps, okay, to estimate Doppler and micro Doppler, to study Doppler and micro Doppler signature. Okay, if we take an illustration, this is a simulation study where we have a rotor with three blades. The blades are running at 300 RPM rotation rate. Okay, so if you look at the range Doppler map, the spread is from minus 3,500 close to plus 3,500 hertz. Okay, at a distance of 20 meters. If we increase, the way to process here is you identify the range, and at this range you extract the signal across subsequent chirps. And if you perform time frequency analysis, you would get the response due to the three blades that are present. Okay, that is the way you generally process. So if you increase the rotation rate to 6,000 RPM, what you observe is the spread has increased beyond minus to plus 4,500 and has wrapped around. Okay, this is the problem of aliasing that we were speaking. Now, if we extract at this particular range, if we extract and across the slow time, if you perform time frequency analysis, what happens is you would not be able to extract the original signature at all. Okay, this is the problem that we have been discussing, and requires a lot of effort. I mean, it requires an alternate way to process micro Doppler signature. So the approach is very simple. We have been working on that, and I would quickly go through this. Most often what happens is the FMCW radar IF signal is as shown here. To identify the target range and velocity, what you do is you would get the IF signals one below the other and process across the chirps. Okay, so but this is in contrast to the continuous wave radar, where it continuously processes the IF signal. One of the other differences between continuous wave radar and FMCW radar is the IF signal in a continuous wave radar would have only the Doppler signal and micro Doppler signal. But in a FMCW radar, what happens is the IF signal would have the Doppler and micro Doppler frequency, but it also will have the range frequency. So now, since you know the range or target distance, you can actually compensate for this and extract the original signal, IF signal, which would be very similar to the continuous wave radar, and therefore you can process that without being subject to aliasing. So that's the approach which can have significant potential in target characterization using FMCW radars. Okay, so some of the challenges that we encounter in FMCW radars is one size would not fit all. For one application, the radar parameters would be different. For other, the radar parameters might be different. So there would be some amount of flexibility that radars provide, but if the contexts are too different, then you will have to redesign. So when you have to redesign, the bigger challenges, RF and antenna design, handling phase noise, and a lot of hardware related issues would come up. You'll have to handle them appropriately. With more and more devices, we'll have to be very, very careful with interference. And to handle that, you will have to use phase modulated continuous wave concept or some other kind of concepts to suppress the interference from one radar to the other, and so on. So One other challenge is FMCW radars not applicable for long range applications. In such cases, you should be careful enough to make a decision whether to switch to pulse wave or stick to FMCW radars. And there might be some designs which are infeasible. Such cases, we might have to complement with other sensing modalities. So basically, to summarize, radar is going to be an indispensable sensing modality for future applications. That's sure, that assured. Abundant space is there to identify the use of FMCW radar for new problems. And the way the hardware of FMCW radar is evolving, it is in line with technologies such as GPS receiver. And it's not too far that it becomes a plug and play kind of device kinds. Target identification, scene reconstruction, sensor fusion are some of the open problems which are really, really coming up for interesting applications. Yeah, that's about the presentation. Questions?
Thank you, Vinod. I think there are a couple of questions. Subhajit, you want to go ahead?
Hi, Vinod. Yes, thanks sir. For a very nice talk, introductory. I had a few questions. I missed the earlier part of your talk. I joined a little late. So you mentioned about blind spot in pulse wave wave radars.
Yes. Yes.
Could you explain that to me? And I would say, that would also appear to be similar to in the case of ultrasound. No, the ultrasound and radars are pulse wave radars are,
So certainly there would be a blind spot in most of the even ultrasound systems, wherein when you transmit the signal for a short duration, and until the entire signal is transmitted, you will not be in a position to receive the signal, and therefore, if the target is very close to the system, then the system cannot detect. Okay, but the advantage with ultrasound system is the wave propagation wave is propagated at say 1500 meters per second, as opposed to the radar signal, which is propagating at 3×10^8 meters per second. Therefore, that saves ultrasound, which can be used for targets which are nearby.
Okay, that was one question. Other question was you showed one diagram, FMCD diagrams of the you are resetting the frequency again and again.
Yes.
That was for the next slide probably. Yeah, yeah. So why are you getting responses? On the RX side, you have got these multiple one dashed here and 3-4 lines here.
Okay, this is just an illustration where if you have one target at a specific distance, the response would be a chirp signal, which is slightly delayed. Okay, the time frequency representation of that particular response would look like this. For a target which is slightly farther, it would be another chirp. A target which is farther is another chirp, but the received signal would be a combined signal. Okay. Uh-huh. And if you perform a time frequency analysis, you will not get three lines, you would get one single region, which is a spread over this particular lines. That's what you would see. Okay.
Uh-huh. Oh, that vertical line that you are showing. No.
I'm pointing here, right?
Uh-huh.
So you would get one.
This is a frequency. This is a frequency. Y-axis is a frequency.
Y-axis is the frequency. Yes.
Yes.
Correct. There would be a spread between these two in the time frequency representation of the received signal.
Uh-huh. And these are for the three multiple.
If there are three targets.
Ah, okay.
As an example. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. I think Professor Prasanna had something. Yeah.
Yeah. I'll take a look at that.
Yeah.
How much does multi-sensor IR, IR visible the radar's performance in any one standard setting with flutter? Ground penetration radar versus free space. So how much does multi-sensor IR visible light sonar improve the radar's performance? Foolproof integration of all these sensors has not been completely successful, but people have been working. One such instance is autonomous driving. And I'm less informed about the recent developments of the integration of all these modalities as of now. So what is the current state of art in ground penetration radars? I don't know the exact depth capabilities, but yeah, people have been using this for more and more applications of late. And people have been using frequency modulated continuous wave radars for ground penetration radars as well. Okay, so those are some of the variations which have come up compared to earlier days. What is the advent of tiny ML running on low power microcontrollers? Can we utilize some techniques to clean up the detected signals, the detector in FMCW radars? Maybe we can infer more from the received signal to get better map in a region. Certainly we can. This is one of the possible ways where we can improve the performance of FMCW radars to detect signals and infer more. What I would say is there might be some mechanisms through which we can try to image the entire scene that the FMCW radar is looking at with new approaches such as tiny ML and so on, right? It is possible with the help of these that you can reconstruct the scene with the efficiency of a camera or so on, okay? But the advantage would be you would also have the depth information from the radar, not only the azimuthal and elevational information from the camera as well as the radar. So certainly the scope is infinite, just that accurate design and application is needed. Yeah.
I have a question, Vinod. I was wondering, so you mentioned about scene reconstruction. Is FMCW also used for change detection? You also said it's used in drones and it's not used for long range applications.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So can it be used for change detection and topography and things like that?
By change, what do you mean?
Like change as in usually SAR images are used for, imaging is used for change detection, right?
Yes. Any change in the landscape or so on.
Yes,
correct.
Yeah, and just not the landscape, right? Even for, a disaster management and all of that.
Yes, absolutely. FMCW radar certainly can be used for change detection. In fact, in industrial application, and which I referred to, just to give me. If I go back to the applications, this is one of the application which I worked on, but we were not using FMCW, but I would insist we should use FMCW for this particular application.
This is, Vinod, this is non-destructive testing.
Yes, correct. This is non-destructive testing where they are trying to detect the moisture content in the gap, in the rock wool here, which is used as an insulator. Okay, so here what happens is in the normal condition, the insulator should not have any moisture here. Okay, so due to moisture, basically the pipe gets eroded and therefore there can be a catastrophe on the pipe and therefore we need to detect the moisture. Now, the way they do is they mount the microwave sensors and transmit a signal along the pipe. And what they see is in the presence of moisture in the insulator, there would be some amount of reflection that comes back. Okay, that's like a change in the insulator that is observed. Okay, something like here, water patch. In the presence of water patch, there would be a small component. So this is a small change present in the path. So this could be detected. Similarly, if you are reconstructing the scene, you can certainly identify the change, provided your computational complex, you have powerful computation to process the data in such a fast pace, because data acquisition in FMCW radar is very, very fast, and therefore you should be processing it at an equally fast pace. If it is offline processing, yeah, you can certainly do it. Yes.
Okay. And there's one more question from Shubhayu on power consumption of radar systems. What sort of trade-off do we see between resolution of the detected scene versus power consumption of the system?
Okay, resolution of the radar, at least in terms of the range, is dependent on the bandwidth. Okay, and regarding power consumption, power consuming component is the transmission of the signal. And with the spectrum allocation restrictions applied, the transmitted signal power should not be very, very high. Okay. And since the bandwidth is increased, you can transmit at a low power, and you can reconstruct the signal pretty well with the help of techniques such as match filtering or using signals like FMCW signals. Therefore, there is no specific trade-off between the resolution and power consumption, because you are anyway transmitting at a low power, but there is a trade-off between the, not a trade-off, but the advantage is at higher frequencies, we are provided with larger bandwidths. In the context of automotive radar, the operating frequencies is from 77 to 81 gigahertz, a 4 gigahertz of bandwidth, which can give a very, very high resolution. The resolution in radar, at least the range resolution, is proportional to the bandwidth, or inversely proportional to the bandwidth. If the bandwidth is more, you can resolve targets which are very, very nearby in terms of centimeters, I'm saying. So that's the kind of accuracy that you get with FMCW radars. Basically, the advantage is because you are operating at very high frequency.
Vinod, Shiva here.
Yes, Shiva.
This aliasing part, is it a necessary evil in FMC, or is it because you are sampling too fast?
So aliasing occurs along the Doppler domain. The reason is, if you look at the response from one chirp to the other chirp, okay, so the time spacing between one chirp and the other chirp is chirp repetition interval, which may be about 100 microseconds, which means while you are processing across the chirp, the sampling, effective sampling frequency is 1/100 microseconds, for example. That would be what, say 10 kilohertz. Okay. So if the Doppler frequency is greater than plus or minus 5 kilohertz due to the target velocity, then what happens is there would be aliasing.
Agreed.
So that is the biggest problem. If you want to process from one chirp to the other chirp across the slow time. So therefore, for example, if the targets such as drone are present, you cannot characterize such targets if you process across the slow time. And that is the actual work which we have been working on. We should not be, the trick there is, we should not be using, you should not be working on across slow time and fast time. You should be working on along the fast time itself. I mean, I ran through it pretty fast. Mm. What we did is, instead of making packing these one below the other and looking across the chirps, what we do is we pack it here, and this signal is a continuous signal with a higher sampling frequency.
Mm.
First thing is higher sampling frequency. Second thing is we know the target range, and we can remove the range frequency here. We can remove the range frequency here. Okay. If we remove the range frequency, it would be high sampled signal with Doppler as well as micro Doppler components.
So basically, you are deconvolving there.
Yeah, we are using this in a continuous wave radar sense, where aliasing does not happen because you have a very high sampling frequency here.
No. When you are trying to reconstruct the signal, you are deconvolving the TX so that you get the actual signal.
See, we are not deconvolving. This is the received signal. Okay, this is the received signal. You multiply with the transmitted signal and you filter it. You get the low pass filtered signal. For this particular received signal, this is the IF component, correct?
Mm.
For this chirp, you get this as the IF signal and so on.
Mm.
Conventionally, the way they study is they put this here and get all the chirps one under the other and process across the chirps to estimate the target Doppler velocity, Doppler frequency, and therefore the velocity, and micro Doppler as well.
Mm.
Correct? Across this, the sampling frequency is 10 kilohertz, which is way too less.
Mm.
Okay. But if we observe this signal as a continuous wave signal, what did we say? Here, FMCW radar, in the FMCW radar, IF signal frequency, this signal is proportional to, firstly, the range frequency, the Doppler, as well as micro Doppler. All three are present here, even
exactly.
Here.
That
even
is exactly here. What I'm asking, that when you have all the three signals and you are keeping this signal in between to make it a continuous.
Yes.
When you want to reconstruct the signal, the actual signal, you deconvolve from this complete IF signal, whatever.
Yeah,
other...
from this IF signal, what we do is we, if you first look at this kind of processing, you know how far the target is.
Mm.
Okay. So once you get the target, what you do is you remove the range frequency from this particular signal.
Yeah, that removing the range frequency, how is it done? Is it a deconvolution operation or is it a simple demodulation operation? That is the question.
You can demodulate it.
Okay.
You can demodulate it, yes.
That was the question, actually.
Thanks, Vinod. Are there any more questions for Vinod? I think there are no more questions. Thank you, Vinod, for the nice talk.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks, Vinod. Yeah.
It has been a great talk.
Yeah.